Hi guys, thank you very much for joining, and equally thank you very much for your patience over the last few weeks. I hope you all had a very good Christmas and a happy new year, and I wish you and yours all the very best for whatever lies ahead for this new year. Whatever you choose to do, make it good. Whatever you choose to do, it's very important to do what you want to do. It's the only way. You can only be yourself, so good luck with that. Welcome back to the remake of the Tire Tracks. If you don't know already, these are remakes of original videos that I did in 2017, where I gave the viewer the opportunity to read statements for themselves with a bit of music. However, the feedback I got from those videos were that people couldn't really read what was being shown on the screen, so I'm remaking them now. This one's called the Tire Trap. As you'll know, if you're following the videos, we've just literally created a pathology report on the scene. It's a pathology report from somebody called Dr. Lanas. And Dr. Lanas is the pathologist who examined the scene on the 7th of December. And her job was just to basically describe everything that she saw. The video to the pathology report on the scene is up on the channel. Please do go and have a look. In that video, I miss out one particular paragraph because I can now remake this Tire Tracks video using that very paragraph. And it's this one that you're seeing on your screen here. It reads, "Deep mud filled tire tracks passed under the gate and for about 20 meters beyond it. Beyond the tire tracks were covered with snow. Small puddles of slightly muddied water showing deep red staining filled the tire tracks leading from the car up to the gate and beyond the gate." So this that you're seeing on your screen now is the Range Rover from above. These photos have become quite common, and I just need to show you these so we know where the gate is in the other ones, because you can't really see it. So can you see that there? This here is the gate. There's the front of our Range Rover, and you can very vaguely see it right there. It's not very clear, but it is there. And this one, we're looking around there, aren't we? That there, I would say, is where the gate is, or even a little bit further down. So I would say that the gate is about there, give or take a couple of feet. Literally, it's not that far off, is it? Can you see what I've done there? So I've actually drawn our gate in there, so it's about right, give or take a couple of feet. Okay, so Dr. Lana says the deep mud filled tire tracks, mud filled tire tracks, passed under the gate and for about 20 meters beyond the gate. So if we zoom out there, you can actually see quite a good shot of where I think she means that the snow actually starts to fill in these tracks. I think that right there is where she means tire tracks came through the gate up until 20 meters, and then after the 20 meters, the tire tracks, they still go on, but the tire tracks are filled with snow, which suggests at one point all of these tire tracks would have been filled with snow. However, our vehicle has come through the gate, continued on through the gate. Obviously, the gate was open at this point. The vehicles drove up 20 meters, stopped, and then reversed, and then made its way back to wherever it came from, leaving the tire tracks mud-filled. Does that make sense? After 20 meters, the mud-filled tracks, they continue, but they're filled with snow. So a vehicle's come up, stopped, and then disappeared somehow. Personally, I would suggest it's reversed out, but nobody knows. Now, zooming in on this, I need to choose my words carefully, because I was going to say clearly it shows that these tire tracks are filled with snow, but it's not really clear, so I'm not going to say clearly. But you can see what she means. Okay, so she's saying 20 meters after the gate. It's fairly obvious that those bits there have absolutely no snow in it. They are just pure mud-filled tire tracks, aren't they? You can see for yourselves there's no snow in there. It's quite difficult because we are so far up. But here, all down to here, are just tire tracks. mud-filled tire tracks. That's how she explains them. And then I would say from there onwards, she says 20 meters, they go on, and all this is snow-filled. Okay, so I tried to work out where exactly she means these 20 meters are, and the only way that we're going to be able to do that is to find out how long this Range Rover is. And to my surprise, I still don't believe it. I don't think I've looked at this properly, but I'm more than sure that I have. Okay, the internet is saying that the Range Rover was 4 meters long. You can see for yourselves, this is what Google's saying. I've typed in Range Rover Classic Vogue dimensions, and up it pops right away. Look, wheelbase 100 inches, 2.5 meters, length 4.445 millimeters, which is 4.4 meters. And I suppose this means like 4.648 millimeters, which is 4.6 meters from front bumper to back bumper. And the reason why I find that so difficult to understand is because, I mean, I'm sat in my living room here now, and my living room's 5 meters. I've just measured it, so it's 5 meters long. And to look at that, I mean, I just can't believe the Range Rover, any car's that long. That seems to me that it was a mega, mega massive car. I honestly don't think that's right, but that's what it's saying. Nearly 5 meters long. Anyway, we'll have to go with that, 5 meters. So with this art studio here now, I can cut the Range Rover out there, look. So say there, 4.5 meters. I'd be right about there. So look, so we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, and just for argument's sake, so say 4.5 meters, just for argument's sake. Dr. Landas does say about 20 meters, so our Range Rover's nearly 5, it's 4.5, so I've just put it as 5 Range Rovers worth. And it does come up to about there, look, ish. So it's about there. It's suggesting a vehicle's come through and then disappeared. Now, whilst I'm here, I picked up this when I was looking at this photo from above, and it does look like our vehicle has taken a different route here, doesn't it? And then stopped there. All of this seems to be snow-filled, and can't really discount that, but that, again, does look like snow-filled tracks. I would say that does. But this track here does seem to divert off there, doesn't it? So that said, there could have been 2 vehicles that have come through and then stopped. Unless this has gone round like that and joined it. I can't see anything there to suggest that that does do that though. That doesn't go anywhere, but you know, it does look like it, doesn't it? So now I may be mistaken with this, but I'm more than sure that this field here is grass. It is grass, actually. I know it's grass. I've seen it, and we'll have a look at that in a minute. So I was just about to say those tracks there look similar to those there in that field, and this is a ploughed field. So I was wondering just for a second if this field was ploughed, and they look like the tractor marks in a ploughed field, don't they? But I just had a memory recall there. This whole field here is grass. So you'll have to make up your own mind there, guys. I honestly don't know if that is these are tire tracks going off and then stopping. I don't know, maybe. But I suppose you're gonna have to use your own imagination here as well, because I have no facts other than what Dr. Lanas has said. I have no facts. If we are to look for theories, however, regarding this, I would say the gate was open, a vehicle's come through, and maybe somebody's met them. Maybe, because this field is the field to the shooting range. And you know what I'm like with this shooting range. I believe something, that shooting range is connected to these murders somehow. I honestly can't get my head round how it can't be. What would they be doing there? They were looking for guns. Maybe they came to rob it. I don't know. Maybe they were shooters. I'm getting a lot of that lately, actually. I'm seeing that a lot of Essex folk are into shooting. I know Pat Tate's son is into shooting now. Because it's countryside, it's quite a common sport. It's quite a popular sport. And I honestly imagine Tony Tucker to have been a shooter. He rode horses. He was a country boy sort of kind of thing. He seems like he was out in the sticks. He appreciated being out in the sticks, you know, in his bungalow alone in the countryside. Billy Blundell, Eddie Blundell, both shooters. They enjoy that sport. We've seen that in the documentaries of the Blundells. The first sight, the first picture of the UC is Billy already shooting his gun in his field. They'd already tried the machine gun in Tony's garden, which is more or less a field. It is massive. So could they have been coming up here to maybe ask for permission to go up and fire a machine gun? And they were followed. But it would seem that the Range Rover or our vehicle has come through this gate as it was open. It's been stopped. Maybe somebody's stood there going, yo, I'm here. You know, put both hands up. Stop. And they've stopped. The person's got in, and then Craig's reversed out, and then the person has got out the back door and then gone to close the gate, and then by surprise, somebody's killed them. I mean, that's a theory in itself, isn't it? That I mean, that's another way that a fourth man could have got into the back. Tony Pat and Craig came down here alone, which, according to Rebecca Carr's statement, there was only three of them in the Range Rover anyway. They went down there with a white Sierra. That was about 5:45, so they could have gone anywhere after that. But there was another apparent Range Rover, greeny blue, seen entering that lane at about 6:45. We don't know if that was Tony Pat and Craig. Tony Pat and Craig were seen, they were identified at the turnpike following a white Sierra at 5:45. And they turned in to White House Farm. Personally, I think that was Tony Pat and Craig. And then there was no sighting of a Range Rover with a Sierra pulling out. And you would have thought, wouldn't you, because it was quite a busy time of night, there was traffic on that road. You would have thought with the police asking for information, can anybody remember anybody who went down there? You would have thought at least one person would have said, yeah, you know, I remember a blue Range Rover pulling out. We've got two sightings of a Range Rover at the turnpike being followed and turning into White House Farm. Then we've got another sighting of another Range Rover, bluey green, turning in to the lane. So if Tony Pat and Craig at 5:45 turned into White House Farm and then turned back out onto the road to go somewhere else and then to turn up again 3/4 hour later or an hour later, you would have thought that they would have been seen again with this white Sierra, again pulling out of White House Farm, you know, with the police there saying, look, can anybody help us? Got those sightings of them pulling into the lane, but we haven't seen them pulling out. You would have thought if they did pull out of the White House Farm, they would have been seen, especially that time of night being busy. But there aren't any sightings of Tony Pat and Craig or a Range Rover pulling back out onto the road with a white Sierra. It just didn't happen. So I personally believe that Tony Pat and Craig went down there with the white Sierra, turned into White House Farm, and they stayed there, and they waited for somebody. So, if we're going to go with that, then they came down here, possibly followed by the white Sierra, we don't know. I doubt it, because that road, that lane, is very bumpy. I don't think it's fit for a car, to be fair. Although, Ivan Dibley went down there, didn't he? In his Volvo, his red Volvo. I don't know how long ago after that was, and I know they started work on it. Have you seen the video of the Land Rover reconstruction going down there, though? And it's bumpy. It's very bumpy down there. So I can't see a Sierra actually making it all the way down there. but this Range Rover would have. And it's just another way that a fourth man could have got into the Range Rover. They came down here, they came through the gate. The geezer here puts his hands up, says, look, yeah, I'm here. Maybe he's got guns. That's why they're there. They want his guns. It pulls up. The bloke gets in the back of the Range Rover. The Range Rover pulls back out. This bloke says, stop. It is a plan. Somebody else is in this bush. He opens the back door, gets out, goes to shut the gate. He does shut the gate. And this bloke does actually jump out and kill him. That's the plan. And like I say, in the Pathologist of the Scene video, there's absolutely no way of the police finding who they picked up, because this gate's shut and locked. And because the Range Rover is sat in front of this locked gate, that blows all inquiry out, doesn't it? They've pulled up to this gate. We've always been led now. They've pulled up to this gate, which was locked. They found it locked. So the police are assuming it was locked when they got there. This is saying otherwise. This is saying, these tire tracks are saying that the gate was open. They went through the gate. They went on for 20 meters. Something happened at 20 meters. Maybe somebody got in there and then they reversed out. And then somebody closed the gate. And that's why we can't work it out, because the gate's locked. If the police would just open their minds just a little bit and say, okay, well, if the gate was open and they did go through there, that should mean that they're there meeting somebody, or they've seen somebody they don't want to see and they've tried to leg it. But Pat and Tony being Pat and Tony, I doubt that very much. I would assume they trust this person they've gone up to meet. I'm thinking they've gone up to get guns. These blokes said, look, yeah, I'll be at this range all day, or I'll be hunting in these fields. Come and pick me up. I've got some guns for you. You've been looking for them. They were looking for guns. They would have phoned around. They would have phoned around all the people they know who would have had guns. You know, they phoned Mickey Bowman. Mickey Bowman said, yeah, I've got one. So they got that. And it may be that somebody just phoned him and said, yeah, okay, you're after guns. Yeah, oh, look, mate, come up to the shooting range. I'll be there. Come and pick me up about 6:30. I've got some guns for you. So they have. They've just gone up and they said they've met him in the field as well, because the gate's open. And he's got in, come all the way back, and as I say, opened the gate. Somebody else, slyly though, has literally blown them away. Possibly the bloke who was in the cars in this field. He's walked over here knowing that they'd be up here. But, you know, I suppose that all goes down with the phone tapping. If they had their phones tapped, which is very possible they did, somebody may have been listening to a phone call to say they'll be here tonight. This bloke they've gone up to meet, who's hunting in this field, is completely innocent. He's saying, look, I've got guns for you. End of story. Come and pick me up. He's probably dodgy. You never know. He's got to be dodgy, because he hasn't come forward for what he saw and what he witnessed. For some reason, I'm not feeling, if this is a man that he's gone to meet, I'm not feeling that he was involved in this setup. However, he did run away after witnessing it. He went to shut the gate. End of story. And then somebody did actually jump out and fuck them all up. And then the bloke they went to meet was like, I wasn't expecting that, you know, like, fucking, I'm not involved. They just literally, they were looking for guns. Little bit of an argument. He's told to fuck off, and which he has. It wouldn't be Mick, would it? It wouldn't be Mick. You know what would be really handy now is if we had alternate footage looking into the field at these tire tracks. It would be really handy if we had like images or videos of, you know, the coppers looking at or looking around this part. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we do. Take a look at this. Right, so as you saw there, video images of the police looking at these tire tracks. I've took a few still shots of these. Now, what I find interesting about these are these five coppers in the background here. Those bad boys. Who I believe are these. Now, as you can see in the background here, these are on what seem to be examining something that is in our area of interest. They seem to be hanging around that 20 meter mark. In the video, obviously, they are walking, but they're walking very slowly. But this gives you a better image of the tire tracks that we're talking about. I know they're a bit vague, but you can see what Dr. Lanas is on about. Now, personally, I don't know exactly what day these were taken. I can only imagine they were taken on the 7th. You know, when the police investigation got underway. 7th, 8th, 9th, I don't know. But whatever date it was, the ground has been properly preserved. I'm sure you'll agree there. Now, this is in front of our gate. And I know that because of this here. Can you see that right down here in the corner? Left-hand corner. I can blow that up a bit. Right in the corner here is our gate. Here, look. You see that? Okay, so there's the top rung of our gate here. So this photographer has virtually got the camera resting on the top rung of the gate. I don't know if the Range Rover's behind this person, but you can clearly see here that this is what Dr. Lanas is on about. This bit here, can you see that? Personally, I can't see any blood staining in these puddles. I honestly can't. But in this one, you'll notice that there isn't any snow-filled tire tracks. And it just doesn't seem like there's any snow in this field at all. This seems like it's long grass. So the snow will have fallen down to the ground and this grass would have been coming up over the top of it. But it just gives you a better picture of what she's on about here. And it's interesting, isn't it, that these coppers are working at around the 20 meter mark. And basically what that's saying to me is that they absolutely 100% definitely believe themselves that something happened around that mark. Correct me if I'm wrong, you know, what else would it tell you? Dr. Lanas has said that the tire tracks went on for 20 meters. The police are hanging around this area as well. They're examining it. So doesn't that suggest that these coppers actually feel that something, a car, a vehicle came down and something happened at that 20 meter mark? I'm more than sure that those five coppers there in the background are those coppers there. And it's possible, actually, that those two walking in the background there are these two here. See what I mean? Those two there, these coppers here. See, these coppers here are on the track here, and then if these two coppers here are the ones in the next scene, then these coppers have actually moved out onto the grass and they're searching the grass. If you have a look, see what I mean? They've moved onto the grass there. They seem to be hanging around the area. And these two have literally just walked from down here to around here. Obviously, if that is them. Personally, I can't see any blood, which I've already said. But unfortunately, this is one of those videos that you have to make your own mind up. I'm sort of out of ideas of what could have happened here because, I mean, I'm not fresh out of theories. I mean, I personally think the gate was open. For some reason, whilst looking and listening to that bit of information from Dr. Lanas. I'm picking it up for some reason that the gate was open and our vehicle went through. But if you watch this, it's the scene at the end of The Rise of the Foot Soldier.
Gangland, as hundreds of people were questioned. One theory was gaining in credibility. Two names just kept coming up.
Put your hands on the fucking door!
Whoa, what's this about?
I just want a word with you, Puff. Now you tell your boy to follow that car.
I ain't going.
There's no difference whether you drive or I drive. Do you get the picture?
And it's a pretty fucking gory picture of that, sir.
You boys have become a fucking nuisance.
We heard about your little slip out in the pizza parlour, Pat. We spunked in our pants.
Didn't remember how much fucking money you owe us.
Listen to me, please. I'm trying to get all your dough back now.
But what problem you got with Pat is Pat's got fuck what to do with me. Oh, fuck off, Tucker. It's got everything to do with you. You're all involved. All fucking out of control. Ripping off every cunt from here to fucking Hounslow. Well, it stops tonight. Shoot that cunt.
Well, I'll tell you like a man, sir. Ain't that bad. We'll be over in a moment.
Fuck you! You fucking cunt!
But these were just paranoid theories being handed out left, right and centre. The newspapers started printing any old shit from small-time crooks and wannabes. Apparently, Arthur Wessex was an expert on the subject.
I know it's only a theory, but as you saw there, there were two Range Rovers, our Range Rover blue one, and then a Frontera, as far as I can tell, followed it and it led our Range Rover in. That one went through the gate and then somebody closed the gate. It's just another theory. That theory is suggesting that they were killed outside the Range Rover and obviously put back in. It's just another idea of what could have happened. Green Frontera goes through the gate, somebody shuts the gate, and then our Range Rover pulls up to the gate. Whilst we're on that subject, actually, and whilst we're on that theory, the Hexel brothers here that are being portrayed in Rise of the Foot Soldier are actually portraying Billy and Eddie Blundell. There are no Hexel brothers, and that whole theory is suggesting that Pat borrowed 40 grand off Billy and Eddie to pay for the Dud cannabis deal. See into that what you will, just a bit of trivia. But look what happened to that Dud cannabis deal. It fell apart, didn't it? And, you know, Pat only put 10, 20,000, 20, 30,000 into that. So, you know, he would have lost that whole 40,000. I wonder if Billy and Eddie would have taken that as a robbery. Anyway, guys, thank you very much for your time. As I say, this is one of those videos that you're going to have to start making them your own. You're going to have to kind of make your own mind up. There's only a few theories that can be cast here, really, is that our vehicle went through and then reversed out and then the gate was shut, or just like that at the end of the Rise of the Foot Soldier there, our vehicle went through, then the gate was shut and ours pulled up behind it. There's a, you know, it doesn't go anywhere, really, but all I can say is that the police believe something happened at the 20 meter mark after the gate. It seems that way anyway. It does seem that the police actually thought that. You know, I may be looking into that all wrong. Those police may just be doing their routine checks. You know, I'm not suggesting that they were working at that point 20 meters into those tracks all day, every day. But from what I'm looking at here, it would suggest they've been told to go up and search that place, search there. So it does speak out to me personally, and it says that the pathologist and these police believe that something went on at that 20 meter mark with our vehicle. Whether they went through, whether it was Tony Pancraig and they went through and then were shot there at the 20 meter mark, and then pushed out, maybe, or pulled out by a winch. We're never going to know, are we? That's that. I mean, that's where that stops. That's the end of that. Obviously, I would love to hear your own theories about what you believe these tire tracks are. They are something. You know, what happened with his gate? Was it open when Tony Pat Craig arrived? And Tony Pat Craig went through and then reversed out? Is that possible? Or was it shut and they pulled it behind? And those tire tracks... You see, this is what I can't understand, is how there's snow-filled tire tracks after 20 metres. Something went through as this gate was open. Our vehicle went through as this gate was open. It would be very interesting to find out when it was shut and locked. Because we know there was heavy snowfall about 5:30. It was really snowing heavily at 5:30. And this is what caused the new layer of snow. All of these tire tracks would have had snow in them at around 5 o'clock, 5:30, easily, because it was heavily snowing. Apparently everybody had to slow down on the roads, it was snowing that much. So all of this, where there was a brand new layer of snow, all these images that you're seeing here now are after the day after, so there would have been a lot of defrosting going on. The water that you see in these puddles are probably there because of the defrosting snow. So that said, as all the tire tracks have got snow in it, our vehicle has come up through the snow up to 20 meters and then stopped. That was about 5:30. Tony Pat and Craig are spotted at 5:45. Could that have been them that went in to the gate, through the gate, 20 meters? Did they wait for somebody? Did they then reverse out thinking they weren't coming? Did Tony get out and shut the gate? That's why his boots are covered in mud. Did Tony shut the gate? Did he get back in and then somebody turned up, pulled up behind them, opened the back door and killed them? It's just one of those things that we're never going to know. This gate, as I suggest in the pathologist report on the scene video, is very important. I mean, if this gate has a part to play in the planning of these murders, then I would say that, I mean, that is planning by a mastermind. I can only call it a mastermind, because how would you think of that? And it's obviously somebody who knows this place very, 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 very well. Or it's, I mean, I would suggest personally, it was somebody who knows this place very, very, very well. But then again, it could be, if we're talking about a mastermind here, then he would just need one visit, wouldn't he? Get them here, get them to this gate, tell them to go through this gate, leave the tire tracks, tell them to reverse, get them back in front of this gate. As long as we lock this gate, the police can't do shit. The police will never know anything. Kill them in the field and then pull the Range Rover back out and then lock the gate. The police won't know anything, because the police can't do anything other than guess. And the police will only believe that they've pulled up to the gate. So that just... clears the killer of murder immediately, if you think about it. Obviously, if the police do decide to go along that trail of thought that they've pulled up to the gate and the gate was locked when they arrived, obviously, if the police started saying, okay, this gate must have been open and they've pulled up and they were killed in this field and then winched out and then the gate was shut, then the police would be onto something, the real truth. But the killer seems, if that's true, of course, the killer has planned that out so well that he knows that the police are just going to assume they've pulled up to the gate, it was locked, and then they're going to go with that. That's the reason why nobody can work it out. Amazing. Anyway, I really hope you enjoyed that, guys. Again, thank you very much for your patience over the last few weeks. If you've got anything to say about this, please do leave it in down below in the comments, because This could be nothing, or it could be everything, couldn't it? I'll see you in the next video, guys. Take care of yourselves.